Bye, Mr. True. Let's take a look at Dumois' theorem and learn how to expand complex numbers in polar form. I'm going to help explain, you know, where this pattern comes from, do not a proof, but start to show you where that pattern shows up, so you can kind of see where that comes from and do one example. In the next video, linked above, we're going to use the Dumois' theorem to find the root of some complex numbers in polar form. But for now, how is it that we can just take a complex value of r cosine theta plus I sine theta, raise it to just some ridiculous power like the seventh power, which is our next, which will be the example I do, and just say, well, you just take the radius, raise it to the n power, and do the cosine of n times theta plus I sine n theta. And you can see this is a pretty simple looking formula. So even if I take this complex number to the seventh power, I can pretty much just write the answer. And this is why. Here we have a complex number in polar form of r cosine theta plus I sine theta. And if you don't want to see, this isn't really going to be a full proof, but if you want to just skip the next few minutes and just get to the example, go right ahead. But we're going to take this complex number in polar form and square both sides. And I'm going to show you the amount of work it takes just to raise this complex number only to the second power, and then hopefully point out how you can see the pattern in this formula and just apply it in the next example. Okay, so I'm going to take this and square it. Now this is going to be kind of like power to power. I'm going to distribute this power of 2, and kind of missed there, but it's going to be equal to r squared, that's, I missed that line, times the cosine of theta plus I sine theta squared. Well, you know, my students like to shortcut this squaring a binomial all the time to get the wrong answer, but when you square a binomial, you should be getting three terms, excuse me. So I'm going to go ahead and drop that power of 2 and just write this twice. And start the distributive property of putting those two binomials together. So we're going to have r squared, and that's going to be times cosine is cosine squared theta, and cosine times 1 or I sine theta is positive I sine theta cosine theta. So that is these two multiplications, and now let's continue the distributive process, and we get I sine cosine again, I sine theta cosine theta, and then plus I squared, because I times I squared sine squared theta. Now, normally if it were just a regular binomial, it'd end up with three terms. We're going to only end up with two, and this is why. R squared. And what do we have? Well, let's not forget that I squared, I is the square root of negative 1. So I squared is going to be replaced with negative 1. So we have cosine squared theta, and then with the I squared, minus sine squared theta. And we have I sine cosine theta. Those are like terms, so we're just going to add those together. Okay, so I said we're going to end up with two terms, and we have three, 1, 2, and 3. But within these three terms, we have some double angle identities. Cosine squared minus sine squared is the cosine of 2 theta. And plus I, 2 sine theta cosine theta, 2 sine cosine is the right-hand side of the double angle for sine. So 2 sine theta cosine theta is the sine of 2 theta. So z squared is equal to r squared times cosine of 2 theta plus I sine of 2 theta. Now if I wanted to raise this complex number to a third power, it would be z squared times z. And I could take this and multiply it again by r cosine theta plus I sine theta, but that would be even more work, and you can already start to see the patterns show up. I took this complex number in polar form and raised it to a second power, and indeed we do have r squared. I took this complex number in polar form and raised it to a second power, and we have 2 theta. And again, 2 theta. So you can see how Dumov's theorem is working here. We have r to the n power times the cosine of n theta plus I sine n theta. And indeed, we have that pattern, or that pattern show up even with a power of 2. And if you go to power 3 and 4 and so on, that pattern will continue. So there's not a proof, it's incomplete for a proof, but a demonstration of how this pattern shows up and a little bit about why the Dumov's theorem works. So let's use that theorem to do an example. And I'm actually going to kind of do 2 examples at once. I would like to raise negative 1 plus I to the 7th power. Well, that complex number is not even in polar form, so we're going to get that complex number into polar form, which is going to be a little bit of work, and then we're going to raise it to the 7th power, but that's still going to be less work than me trying to do negative 1 plus I raised to the 7th power, me writing that 7 times and trying to do all those distributive processes over and over and over and over and over again. So even though this example is going to be a little bit long, it's still a lot less work than just trying to raise that to the 7th power. So, we need to first review how do you get a complex number into polar form. Well, the first thing you're going to want to do is graph it. So this is left one and up one. Clearly I'm not going to make a value that or a point that's super hard to work with. And a complex number in polar form is r cosine theta plus I sine theta. So I need to find r, the distance that complex number is from the origin, or the absolute value of z, and then find theta. So r is equal to the square root of a squared plus b squared, or the square root of negative 1 squared plus 1 squared. And that's, of course, going to be the square root of 2. Now, theta. My x and y coordinates are the same, so hopefully, well, my real and my imaginary values, my real value and my coefficient of the imaginary part of the complex number, they're the same. I mean, you know, negative 1 and 1. So theta, you could probably already know, is going to be 135 degrees or 3 pi over 4. But if it were an angle that we couldn't just do in our head, we'd be doing the tangent of theta is equal to b over a, or 1 over negative 1. And theta is equal to the inverse tangent, therefore, of negative 1. And if you were using your calculator, the calculator would tell you that this were equal to negative 45 degrees. I'm going to do this in radians. And again, I have an answer that's kind of basically kind of like on the unit circle. If you've been studying trig, I certainly figure you are if you're watching this video. So you might get negative 45 degrees, you know, if you have a calculator in degree mode because of restrictions on the inverse trig functions. But negative 45 degrees is in quadrant 4. My point is in quadrant 2. So let's get to the deal here. Theta is 3 pi over 4, because I'm going to do this problem in radians. So just make sure that when you're trying to find theta, when you're going from complex form into polar form of a complex number, that theta value that you end up using gets you in the appropriate quadrant. Don't just take the number out of the calculator if that's what you're using to come up with the answer and just think, oh, that's it. All right. So this comes out to z equals the square root of 2 times the cosine of 3 pi over 4 plus I sine of 3 pi over 4. So now I have my complex number in polar form. I would like to raise that to the 7th power. So z to the 7th power is going to be this complex number in polar form. Raised to the 7th power. And the Dubois theorem says, simply take the square root of 2, or the r, and raise it to the 7th power. And then take that power, that 7, that n, and multiply it to all the angle measures. So it's going to be cosine of 7 times 3 pi over 4, plus I times the sine of 7, times 3 pi over 4, and we get the cosine of 21 pi over 4 plus I sine of 21 pi over 4. And what to do about the square root of 2 to the 7th power? Well, you could come out with it, just, you know, do it off the top of your head. The square root of 2 times the square root of 2 is 2. So 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8. And so it's 8 square root of 2. You could, if you can't do it in your head, maybe do a little bit of scratch work, like this is equal to 2 to the power over root. And that could be rewritten as 2 to the 6 over 2 power times 2 to the 1 over 2 power, and 6 divided by 2 is 3, and 2 to the 3rd power is 8. 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8, and power over root, 8 squared to 2. So, you know, whatever. If you're a little bit weak on your radical notation and powers, you can write it in fractional, you know, write your powers as fractional exponents, and work it out that way, any kind of multitude of way. But anyway, I'm not going to be happy with square root of 2 raised to the 7th power. So it's 8 square root of 2. That's how you take a complex number and convert it into polar form, and then take that polar form, that complex number in polar form, and raise it to a very, very high power using Dubois' theorem. That's it. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework. No, that was not it. This question started off in complex form. I left my answer in polar form. That might be okay, however, might not. So let's take this number that is in polar form, this complex number in polar form, and put it back into rectangular form. So that's going to be 8 square root of 2. Now the cosine of 21 pi over 4. There are multitude of ways you can do this. You can simply just count it out, which is what I'm going to do. And we have 0, we got 1, 2, 3, 4 pi over 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 pi over 4. So full rotation is 8 pi's over 4. So if I do another full rotation, it's going to be 16 pi over 4, 17 pi over 4, 18 pi over 4, 19 pi over 4, 20 pi over 4, 21 pi over 4 in quadrant 3. So the cosine of 21 pi over 4 is negative square root of 2 over 2 plus I, and the sine of 21 pi over 4 that's below the x-axis if you're doing standard position rotation, that'll also be negative square root of 2 over 2. And now when I multiply through my 8 square root of 2's, what's going to happen? Well, we have 8 times negative 1, and square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 2. So square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 2. Oh, and we have a denominator of 2. So square root of 2 times square root of 2 is 2 is going to cancel out with the denominator of 2 and just leave me with negative 8. And this is also negative, so minus 8i. Now that's it. Now I'm done. Bam! Go do your homework.